So here's our theme verse, Romans chapter 12. Before I get into what I'm going to talk to you about today, I want to read this again to you from the New Living Translation, Romans 12, verse 2. It says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. So all of the behaviors and customs that we grew up looking at, and they were modeled for us, some behaviors, weren't they? Some relational behaviors were modeled for us, and we just fell right in suit. Now we treat her like he treated her, and it's not good, is it? And so now we're just following the behaviors and the customs of this world, and I'm telling you guys, especially in this area of relationships that we're talking about today, this is an area where you cannot afford to copy how the world does relationships, because it just does not work. And he follows up that phrase, don't copy the behaviors and the customs of this world, but let God transform you. So here's God's way of moving you from ordinary to extraordinary is him changing you, not you changing them. So God's way for you to have extraordinary relationships is for you to allow God, to let God do a work inside of you. Before you even go to that person, before you try to fix them, before you try to reconcile, God has to do something in me first. Let God transform me. And the reason why I'm highlighting that is because a lot of you would say, Jason, I've tried to work on my relationships, and it just is not good. It just doesn't work. Well, I hear you, but have you let God transform you into a brand new person? Have you tried that? Have you tried allowing God to first change you before you tried to change the relationship? Have you tried that? Have you let God transform you, he says, into a brand new person? Not a retrained you, not a more improved you, not a you after you took good notes in the Extraordinary series. No, a brand new you, a brand new person by changing the way you think. You change your thinking, you can change your life. Because then, he says, then you're going to learn to know God's will for you. Another way to say that is then you can have what God intended for your marriage. Now, if you do that, if you allow God to change you first and transform you first, you can have what God intended for your relationship with your kids. You can have what God intended for your relationship in your business. You can have what God intended for every relationship that matters if you let him do it in you first. Your relationships, and this isn't pie in the sky. You may think it is, but he says, look, your relationships can be good, pleasing, and perfect. That's God's will for you, for your relationships. It's to be good, pleasing, and perfect. And I know that sounds hard to believe, but God wants to empower your relationships. He wants to move them from ordinary to extraordinary. And that's what we hope to do in this series. And today, the topic that we're covering is conflict. Now, there's ordinary responses to conflict, and we see it, oh my gosh, do we not see conflict in today, where there's differing opinions, there's differing thoughts, there's differing beliefs, and it's just the way we conflict with one another, so toxic, it's so hateful, it's despising, it's vulgar, just that's the world's way of doing conflict. If you don't think how I think, believe how I, that's the ordinary conflict way. I want to teach you how to have extraordinary conflict, extraordinary responses to conflict. Some of you're not going to get, your marriage is going to have conflict. It's going to have, your relationships are going to have conflict. How many married people say amen to that? Marriage is going to have conflict, right? You young married in here, you're like, no, it's not. We love each other. No, we're going to be different. You don't know what you're talking about. Get out of here. You're going to have conflict, okay? It's going to happen to you. There's going to be some conflict. Someone said that marriage is like a deck of cards. It begins with two hearts and a diamond. And by the end, you wish you had a club and a spade. Come on. Yeah, conflict is inevitable. But it doesn't have to be ordinary. Come on, church. Conflict is inevitable, but it doesn't have to be ordinary. And God does have a way of dealing with conflict. He does. He has a way that we're supposed to deal with conflict. And in this area, we need to let God transform the way we think. So here's what I want to do in this message. I want to kind of diagnose the areas where conflict comes from. Like, what are the causes of some of the conflict that we're experiencing probably in our lives today? What are some of those causes? What are some of the responses, like the wrong responses that that we've learned and we emotional or whatever it is, we've just learned some responses to conflict that is ordinary. And then how I want to close it out with, how can we move then from ordinary with the help of His Spirit, with the help of God's Word, to have extraordinary relationships in this area, extraordinary responses to conflict, extraordinary responses to conflict. So in order to do that, you guys, I want to first diagnose where they come from. Where does conflict come from? Write these down with me. Here are some areas that conflict comes from, very popular areas. The first one is poor communication. Poor communication. So most conflict actually starts off with something very small, but we make it so huge by the words we pile on top of it. It's like, how did we get here from where this started? Well, it's all the word battling just escalated. You said this, and then he said that, and then she said this, and you guys, it just got out of hand from the words that we spoke into it. Now, I'm not going to talk too much about this point here because I think we need a whole message on this. I think we need to learn how to have extraordinary communication. Look, there is power of life and death in your tongue. Okay? We need to learn how to not have ordinary communication. Look, you are not an ordinary person, child of God. You are not ordinary. You are extraordinary. God has put purpose inside of you, destiny inside of you. Every word that comes out of your mouth is a seed of purpose, is a seed of authority, and we need to learn how to have extraordinary communication and stop doing it the world's way. And so I'm not going to give too much away for this extra, but the poor communication, you guys. Let me just give you a prayer. If that's you, and you know, man, that's how a lot of my conflict kind of escalates. Man, I get to this thing, gets me in trouble, and then she says, and I says, man. Let me give you a prayer from the Bible, from the Scripture. Just, you need to make this your prayer. If this is you, this is your struggle with your words, this needs to be your prayer. This Scripture, like every day, you should read this. Psalm 141, God, set a guard over this thing that gets me in trouble. God, set a guard over my mouth, Lord, and keep a watch over the door. And a door has hinges. A door has hinges that you can control. And what's interesting is, I wanted to go ahead and point this out early, and that is every response to the to conflict is not always, oh, go right to that person. Go. No, we do Matthew 18 here. Yes, you need to go to that person. But the first response to every conflict is, first, I need to go to God. So when you're in conflict and there's a conflicting situation, you need to pray, God, put a guard over this thing, because right now I want to say some stuff. It's not holy. It's not biblical. Put a guard over my mouth, and then I need to go to you first to get this right so I can go to that person and make it right. Okay? So it's God, guard my lips. And I'll file that away. Poor communication. It's very important. We're going to come back to that. Here's another cause of conflict, and you know this, and that is unfulfilled expectations. Unfulfilled expectations. In fact, all of anger can be traced back to this one point. You never got angry at anything your entire life except the fact that you wanted something, you expected something to go a certain way, and it didn't go that way. And now you're frustrated, and now you're upset. The Bible speaks to this directly in the book of James, and we read this in our detox series. If you missed it, I need to put it in here again because it's definitely a cause of conflict. What causes fights and quarrels? What causes the conflict among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something, but you don't get it. So I feel like I deserve a highway without traffic, and when I get it, it just gets me up. And it just, or I feel like I deserve a quiet home. I feel like, and then the kids won't stop, and there's arguing, there's complaining, so I get, because I deserve some peace and quiet, because I work hard, or whatever it is. We wanted something, and we didn't get it. Here's the wrong response. He says, you kill and covet because you cannot have what you want, so you quarrel and you fight. And it goes on to say, and I didn't put it in your notes, but he says, you do not have because you did not ask God. And the truth is, the reason why our expectations are so high is because we're expecting something from people that only God can give us. That's the reason why, I mean, we went to the wrong place. We were holding people to a standard and really to a pressure honestly, some of our relationships, you're putting too much pressure on that person to be something that only God can be in your life. And you're setting them and you up for failure. And that's why you have conflict in a lot of relationships. And although we all have expectations, and I'm not saying expectations is wrong or anything, we all have expectations, but I need to first take that expectation to God. That's the first place I need to take it to, is to God. So first that, we're coming back to that as well. Here's the third one, third cause of conflict. And I'm just trying to highlight some reasons why we have conflict. Here's the third one. We start despising our differences. Despising differences. And look, you guys, we're all different, aren't we? We're different. We have different personalities. We have different... And we get together in a relationship, and those are the things that used to be attractive for us. We used to say, man, look at their strengths. I didn't know you. Like, I don't think like they think, and I don't respond like they respond. And man, that's so cool that you respond that way. You complete me. You must complete me. You're where I lack, you make up. You're, wow. And then after, you know, the honeymoon period, it goes away, and now those strengths now irritate us, don't they? They become despised because not only are your strengths not my strengths, but your weaknesses are not my weaknesses. And can't you just get that right? What's the matter? What's the matter with you? Can't you just? Why don't you just do it like this and do it like that? And so there's just now despising differences, whereas we used to be attracted to that, but now it's like despised. She wants to go fast. You want to go slow. She wants to save. You want to spend. And it's now you're like, ugh. My wife and I, we handle situations differently. Our personalities in some ways are different. Our love languages. We took our love language test in our small group last week, and we have opposite love languages. But that's a good thing. That is a good thing. We balance each other. We support each other. I mean, if I was married to someone just like me, I would kill myself. You know what I'm saying? I can't do that. I mean, be a murder-suicide. It's better to be different. Like in football, we know this. We know this in football. We got the big game, Super Bowl, on this afternoon. In football, we know this, that difference is celebrated. It's a good thing. We don't need 11 people on the field that are 350 pounds, right? That's not going to work. I just need four or five 350-pounders, and then I need a skinny, fast guy in the backfield. Come on. I don't need him fat. I need him fast. And then I need someone who's tall and who can make quick decisions with the ball. Yeah, I mean, in sports, the more different you are, the better the team is. The more different the strengths are, the better the team is. And the same thing is for your relationship. But we don't act that way. And I'm going to say something that I don't say too much about. And it has to do with our in the political arena. And I'm not going to go too deep on it. And I do steer away from this a lot because of how toxic it is. But I'm just going to say America is on very dangerous ground right now. With the way we're acting toward each other, the way we treat each other. Because our government, listen, our government was established and founded upon us having conflicting views. That's the way our government was founded. It was founded on conflicting views, but they knew that there was wisdom, that you have this opinion, we have this opinion, but let's come together and let's have a better opinion. That's the way that our government was founded, but that's not how we respond today. We're so polarized today. This is what I believe, and I hate you believing any different. If you don't believe this way and think this way, then you're evil, you're this, and you're that, and we're so polarized, and it's dangerous. Don't you buy into this ideology of today. Don't you buy into, church, you better not buy into the us versus them. That is the ordinary, common worldly view of doing relationships and conflict. It is not God's way. It's not us versus them. There's a better way. There's an extraordinary way for you to respond to the conflict and to the opposing views that can actually make you better and make them better. I mean, Lord, let us come back to a place where we are the United States of America again. Don't get involved in that. I'm telling you, don't. That's the world's way. We need to come together. Look what Jesus said in Mark 3:25, he said, if a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. So I actually appreciate my wife, and and where she thinks differently and has different, and I say, oh, wow, oh, really? Tell me about that. What do you see? And I appreciate that. It helps me. It covers me. She supports and balances me. But so once again, if I have a conflict, I have to let something happen inside of me first before I'm ever expecting God to do something in that relationship. He needs to do something inside of me. And this leads really to this last source of conflict. And I could have just had this one be the entire list, really, but why we have conflict, and that is this last one: we all have a sin nature. I mean, we all have a sin nature. We are a fallen race. We are an imperfect people. I mean, what were we thinking, expecting anything less than imperfection, than from a fallen people? Why are we expecting so much? And I mean, we're all sinners. And instead of applying that grace and that understanding that we're all a little messed up, man, we hold ourselves to this, oh God, forgive me, I'm just human, but everybody else gets a different standard. Oh no, I'm just human. Oh, forgive me, God. It was just, oh, I'm just human. It's just a, but everybody else, no. Romans chapter 3, 23 says, for everyone has sinned, and we all fall short of God's glorious standard. And so I'm not expecting you to always get it right. Like I'm leaving room for your humanity. Like to it's not always going to be right. Now, can I just pause for just a moment and say this, in this series and in today's topic about extraordinary responses to conflict, this is probably no more highlighted better than in your marriage relationship. But this series and even this message today is for every area of your relationship that matters to you. Okay, you can apply these principles, these extraordinary relationship principles, how to respond to conflict, to every relationship that matters to you. It's just not for the marriage. It's maybe best relates to that, because that is where we're most tested in the most is our marriage relationship. But you can apply this to every area of your life. So how do we handle the conflict? What are some ways that we handle conflict that, and we get it wrong sometimes? Let me give you a few ways. The first way is that some of us handle conflict is my way. My way. It's my way. I'm the boss. I'm the man. I'm the dad. I'm the husband. I'm the, because I said so. That's why. Period. I'm not give you in it, because I said so. That's why. You know, so, and all of us have probably said that in one way, but that's we've tried to pull that one out on conflict. It's my way. It's my way. I said so. Here's another way that we try to respond, and some of us may do it this way. It's your way. Your way. Some of you thought, for the sake of peace, I'm just going, okay, yeah, no, you go ahead. You do that. And we are miserable on the inside. We're miserable, and we're just building up a case, and we're building up bitterness, and the distance is getting further and further. Your heart is getting further and further from that person. That's not working. That's not an extraordinary relationship. Your way, yeah, no. For sake of peace, that's not extraordinary. That's not God's way. My way, your way. Here's another one that a lot of us think this is the right way, and it's not the right way. It's close, but it's not the right way, and that is halfway. Halfway. Like, hey, I'll let you get what you want half the time. Like, you get to do this, and this, but I get to do this, and this. And so you get what you want half the time, and I'll get what I want half the time, and that just made you miserable half the time. It didn't solve anything. It's just 50% of the time now you're miserable. That's not helping anybody. That's not extraordinary, you guys. God has more for you than that. And this is what I hope. This last one is what I hope. I hope to bring this to you every Sunday. I promise you, if you make an effort to come every week to church, you're going to see something that contrasts the world's way, and that is number four, God's way. God's way. God has a way. What's God's way? Well, God's way is I first go to Him and let Him transform me. Then it can be good, pleasing, and perfect. No. Before I'm even going to go reconcile, before I'm going to go put out that fire, before I'm even going to approach that person, God's way is put a guard over my lips, God, and you need to do a work inside of my heart. You need to change me, transform me, God. And oftentimes in counseling a couple, I will practice this principle right here. I'll say, hey guys, I know, and there's some situations that I've seen that have been challenging, difficult, toxic, And oftentimes I'll tell them, okay, hey guys, let's just, I know this, we want to resolve this issue, but do me a favor, let's table this for 2 weeks. Let's just table it for 2 weeks. And for 2 weeks, let's focus on together getting as close to God as we can. We'll get back to that. I know it's important, but just for a couple of weeks, let's focus on our relationship with God and let's get as close as we can to God. And I'm telling you, most of the time, that resolved the issue. Because God needed to do a transformative work in their heart so they can come in to that relationship, not trying to resolve it with their ordinary emotions, with the ordinary way, with the ordinary pattern that they've approached conflict in their life, but they were able to see God's extraordinary pattern of conflict resolution. He was able to open their eyes. Most of the time, just them getting closer to God saw the whole issue. They were able to see it from a whole different light. There's a verse in Ecclesiastes that has a phrase you may be familiar with. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, there was a popular song written about it, but it says, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven." And then there's this long list about the different activities and the seasons of God. But in verse 5, it says this, "There is a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them." And this beautiful poetry from God's Word actually has very deep meaning. I'm going to get to reading where it comes from first in Genesis. And you may want to read that, Genesis 28, 29, on into, even into 30 where we're going to read. But this beautiful poetry, you're like, what does that mean? It's time to scatter stones and gather them. What that means is that you have a choice in every conflict. And you can either scatter the stones or gather them. You can either grab those stones of that abuse and what you told me and you lied and you manipulated and all the stones that you can grab those stones and scatter them all over their head. You can throw those stones at people, or you can gather your stones and create an altar before God. Those are the two choices that you have. You can scatter. You can throw the stones. And some of you are already throwing stones at each other. And you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's ready. It's on the ready. You have it in the sling. You know what you're going to come at him with. Okay? You can either scatter it, you can either throw that stone, or you can build an altar before God. You can gather the stones. Let me read you this, where it comes from, in this beautiful, you should go read that sometime, in Genesis 28 all the way to 31, but it tells the story of Jacob, and where he met this girl named Rachel, and just fell in love with her. God did a great work in his heart. He's just, oh man, I love this girl so much, and I'm going to go ask his father for her hand in marriage. And he goes to Laban, her father, and Laban says, he tells Laban, "What can I do for Rachel, your daughter?" And he says, "Well, you can work for me for 7 years for my daughter." And so he does. The Bible says it went by so fast because he loved her so much. So he works 7 years, and he goes back to Laban and says, "Hey, 7 years is up. Give me my bride." And so on the evening of this night where he was supposed to give Rachel, Laban was supposed to give Rachel to Jacob. Jacob's in the tent, and Laban sends his oldest daughter, Leah, which the Bible says Leah was not as good looking as Rachel. And Laban sends Leah into the tent with Jacob, and Jacob doesn't even realize it's Leah until morning. That's a whole nother message. I don't know what's going on there, but come on, dude. Oh, you're not her. Come on, bro. No, 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 no. Dude. That's the Jason Hannes translation. Don't you take that, please. That was not right. That's not in there. But he wakes up and he says, "Oh, wow, you're not Rachel." And he goes to Laban and says, "Hey, why'd you do this evil to me? You tricked me." And Laban says, "Well, it's custom in our culture to not give the second daughter away before the oldest. We can't do that. You got to take Leah." And he says, "Well, what do I need to do then for your second, for the one I love?" And he says, "Work for me another 7 years." And so he, okay, he loves her so much, he works. And he ends up getting Rachel, but he stays working for Laban for 20 years because he's so manipulative and he's changing his wages. And this relationship between these families now, Jacob's wives and family and servants and his family, so toxic and ugly. It's just a very, very bad relationship. Jacob says one night, "I've had enough." So he takes his wives, he takes his stuff, he takes his servants, and he flees in the middle of the night and he leaves. And then Laban, though, he realizes that, you know, he finds out he's gone, and he goes and chases Jacob down. And Jacob hears Laban is coming, and God has to do a work inside of Jacob because he has a lot of stones against Laban. Years, 20 years worth of stones have been gathered against this man. And then we get this beautiful metaphor here, a little picture in Genesis chapter 31. Watch this, verse 46. Jacob says, he says to his relatives, "Gather some stones. I know we're mad, and we're about to clobber each other right now. And we can either gather these stones and get ready for a fight. It's going to throw down right now. Or we can make an altar." And that's what it means to make a heap. "We can make a heap, an altar before God." So they took the stones, piled them in a heap, and there they ate by the heap. And this is what I want to encourage you to do. This whole message in one sentence is, before you ever try to resolve anything in another person, God's got to first do a work inside of you. And so what my challenge is for every person that's here that has stones, you have a choice. You can gather that abuse, you can gather the bad words that he said or she said to you, and that time he did this, and in that time you can, and you know already what I'm talking about. Your fuse is so short against each other in that relationship. You're at each other's throat. It just takes a quick thing, and ooh, it takes you back to that place, and you have the stones of offense already. It's your choice to either keep those stones and continue scattering them at each other, or make an altar of peace before God. It's your choice. And that, so my challenge and encouragement to you today is, stop trying to work out this conflict the world's way. God has a way, and it's extraordinary. And if you'll stop throwing those stones at the people that you love, of all the offenses and the anger and whatever you built up, and the case I'm sure is great that you've built up, and those stones and those offenses are real. But if you want to move from ordinary relationship, from just the dysfunction and the chaos to extraordinary, then you need to turn those stones into an altar before God. You need to say, "God, do a work inside of me before I'm ever going to go try to reconcile with that person that is, they've done me wrong, they have messed up, but before, no, God, do a work inside of me, transform me, God." Some of you have been you've trapped yourself in your conflict because you've said, "It can never be right until they fill in the blank. It can never be right. I can never be, you know, it's never going to be right until they, whatever it is." And without even knowing it, you've basically put that person in that situation in charge of your own peace and happiness. And that's why you don't get it from them. You don't get it from scattering the stones. You get it from God. You take those stones and you make an altar, and you let God heal you. You let God transform you. So I want to give you a new thought. This is the big reveal of the message today. Write this down. And that is, conflict cannot continue without my participation. Conflict cannot continue without my participation. I don't have to wait for you to decide anything about this situation. I've already decided. And since it takes two to have a conflict, and I'm not going to play the game, there is no conflict. I'm out. I'm not playing that game. I'm letting God do a work inside of me. I'm letting God change me. And some of you are skeptical right now, saying, "Pastor, that's not going to work. No, I don't think that's going to work. You don't know my situation." Yeah, I understand that. But have you let God transform you into a new person first? Like, have you done that? Have you let God change you and transform you into a brand new person? And this is, I'm telling you guys, this is the deep end of the pool right here. Because God is just not a God for you to just, oh God, I need this and I need that, and bless me here and fix this and bless me over here and get them, pay them back, God. Thank you very much. You know, and that's God, that's not the Bible. That's ordinary. That's not extraordinary. That's not in the Bible. The Bible is Galatians 2:20. I am crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but it's Christ who lives in me. I am not my own, I am bought with a price. So the way I respond to this conflict, I don't even have a choice how I respond to it. God has already made my choice. I need to make an altar and let God do a work inside of me. That's the Bible. That's extraordinary. You want to have extraordinary relationships? You want to have extraordinary responses to conflict? I'm encouraging you today to put down those stones that you've been throwing and make an altar before God. That's first. God, change me. And then when you do that, let me give you these four responses to conflict now. Once we make the altar and we say, God, it's me and you. It's not me and them. It's not us versus them. It's none of that. God, it's me and you. I'm building an altar, God. Here's the four responses, the extraordinary responses to conflict. I wrote them as declarations. Here's number one, and that is, I will act and not react. I will act and not react. So I'm no longer going to go wait around for conflict to come and then go, I'm not going to react. I'm going to make some pre-decisions. Some of you married people, if you don't have this, you need it. You need some pre-fight rules. You need to make some pre-fight. Okay, when it happens, there's some pre-decisions. We need to act because we're not going to just react when it comes. No, we need to make some decisions before it comes. Because it is coming. Veronica and I have actually said, when it happens, we're going to respond this way. This is what we're going to do, this is what we're not going to do. And it's based on this scripture, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 and 27. It says, in your anger, so you're angry. I understand you're angry. I would be angry too. It's okay. But in your anger, do not sin. Don't let that anger make you and cause you to do things and act in ways and say some things that are sin. So there's a choice there. You have to act and not react. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. In other words, the Bible is saying, hey, don't go to bed on all that. Don't let it, don't wait, don't hold it, don't wait until tomorrow. If you do, every time you wait till the next day and you put it off, you're giving the devil a foothold. Every day when you put it off, you're just giving the devil more foothold in your life. You're opening a door. So instead, I'm going to say, it's a pre-fight rule. We cannot go to bed angry, honey. We can't do it. We can't do it. So this has really motivated me to say I'm sorry a lot. I mean, it's late. Okay, baby, I'm sorry. It's my fault. You know, let's go to bed. You know, no, we've had some late nights talking, my wife and I, about stuff, and this has really motivated us to get it done. So you gotta have a plan, some pre-fight rules. If you don't have them, you need them. And so I made a little list. They're not in your notes, but they're gonna be up here on the screen. I made some pre-fight rules. These are just some things I've compiled from the Word of God and different sources and that we've just learned. And these are just pre-fight rules that what my wife and I have. Okay, so here they are. Let me just give them to you. Number one, never put it off. Never put it off. In fact, the last fight we had, I won't tell you when it was, but we were having a little disagreement, and I told her, honey, you know we're best friends, and we're going to have to be best friends after this anyway, so we might as well start right now. And she just kind of smiles like, I know. And so it just de-escalated the situation, and we never even got to the whole big issue. It just de-escalated everything. Never, don't put it off. Don't put it off. Don't give the enemy a foothold. Here's the next pre-fight rule, and that is never call names. Never call names. You jerk. You idiot. You weirdo. You're just crazy. You're a crazy woman. Parents, for heaven's sake, don't call your kids names. You idiot. You're supposed to do your homework. What's wrong with you? Man, don't call names. You need to make that. Just don't call names. Number three, never raise your voice. Never raise your voice. Hey, you can say what you got to say without hollering, okay? You can get your point across without yelling and without hollering. Just never raise your voice. These are just some pre-fight rules. Here's another one. Never get historical. No, I didn't say, notice I didn't say hysterical. I said historical. And this is for you ladies today, okay? You got some great memories in the argument. Veronica and I will be in a disagreement. And she's like, and it's just like when you did, or you did it. And I say, when did I do that? When did I say that? 6 years ago, you were wearing the brown sandals in the living room. And I'm like, what are you talking about? You were wearing the button-up shirt. And I'm like, I don't know what shirt I'm wearing right now. This problem is bad enough right now. Don't bring up old problems. Let's just deal with this one right here. Never get historical, okay? Here's another one. Never say never or always. Never say never or always. Well, you never do, and you always. Come on now. No one ever always does anything. Stop over-exaggerating. Don't blow this out of proportion. Never say never or always. And then this last one, this is really important. You need to add this. Never threaten divorce. Never threaten divorce. Throw it out of your vocabulary. I actually have a Webster's Dictionary on my bookshelf. Amen. And I got that my Webster's Dictionary, and I went and scratched out two words, actually. The first one I scratched out was impossible, because nothing's impossible with God. It's not in his dictionary, and it's not in my dictionary either. And then I went and scratched out the word divorce, and I showed it to Veronica, actually. I said, honey, check this out. I just want to show you that divorce does not exist. It's not in my vocabulary. I will never leave you. You can be confident. I am with you forever till death do us part. I'll never divorce you. I may kill you, but I'll never divorce you, honey. All right, here's the second one. I need to go through these quick. Here's the second one. Okay, we need to stop throwing the stones. Make the altar of peace, you God. Let God do a transformative work inside of us. And here's what we need to declare. I will focus on the good things in you. I will focus on the good things in you. So when you get to that altar, God, every day I'm going to be faced with a decision, either on the job or on the highway. I'm going to focus on the good. You may want to write this down, this little side note, you guys. Always separate the conflict from the person. Always separate the problem from the person. The person's not the problem. That person is valuable to God, is precious. Hey, that woman is a princess of God. That's a child of God. That man is an heir to the throne of God. So you know, he's not the problem. The conflict may be the problem, but the person is never the problem. You need to intentionally look at the good in the people, in the good things inside them. Focus on the good things. Philippians 4 talks about this. Verse 8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever. I mean, I can't think of anything, Pastor. I really know this person is a bad, terrible, to his core, he's a bad person. No, there's something there. Find it. Find that something. There's got to be something that's there. Notice I highlighted all the whatevers because some of you think there's nothing there. That's good, Pastor. I promise. I've looked. No, there's something that's true, noble or right or pure or just. Find it and think about it. And then the Bible says, the next verse actually says, not in your notes, but it says, if you do that, you start thinking about that in that other person, then the God of peace that transcends all understanding, he'll guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. You see, it's not even for them. It was actually for you. That's why you need to, God, change me. Transform me, God. Focus on the good. Here's the third thing that I'm going to do in response to conflict at this altar that we're making, and that is, I will apply God's grace to you. I will apply God's grace to you. Now, we all want it for us. Lord, I'll take all the forgiveness I can get my hands on. Yes, thank you, God. But you better make that person pay. Make them pay. Thank you very much. But for me, thank you, God, for forgiving me. But man, will you get them back? Punish them, Lord. It's amazing how much grace we can receive, but how little we can give. Matthew 18 tells this story of this servant who was forgiven like $1 million debt, and Jesus is telling a parable. He forgave him $1 million debt, and that servant that was forgiven went out directly to someone who owed him a couple of bucks, and he had him thrown in jail. And the Bible says that this infuriated Jesus. His anger turned against him. And the Bible says this in Romans chapter 12, verse 19. It says, do not take revenge, even if they deserve it. I know it was wrong. I know it was hurtful. I know they were manipulative. I know, yeah, I understand. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it's mine to avenge and I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. Okay, look, there's an ordinary way of doing conflict. But you want God's way? The world's way is one way. We all know it well. And we all operate that way very well. But there's an extraordinary way of doing conflict. And God says, yeah, you know that person that hates you? You know that person that despises you? If he's hungry, feed him. Feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. And in doing this, you will reap burning coals on his head. Now, I like that part. I get to burn him. I want to see him on fire. Burn him, God. Burn him. No. Some people take that verse out of context. That's not what that verse means. You know what that means? That burning, the coals, are a picture and a metaphor of a remorse in their heart. What he's saying is this, that your kind actions that you're repaying their evil for will actually lead to their repentance. They'll look at you and go, what in the world is going on here? How could they do that? It'll burn repentance in their heart. So this is what he said. Do not be overcome by evil, but, let's say this last phrase out loud, but overcome evil with good. One more time, overcome evil with good. That's what we need to do. That's God's way. Now, we build an altar every day. Instead of throwing those stones, you build an altar with them. You can do this, you guys. And some of you are thinking like, no, that's too hard. I can't do that in that relationship. Maybe in this relationship, but there are some relationships that just, no way. I can't build an altar for that one. It's too hard, which you are right. You cannot have this extraordinary relationship, and you cannot have these extraordinary responses to conflict if really you don't do this last one. It all hinges right here on this last one, and that is, write this one down, and we're going to close. I will remember God's grace to me. I will remember God's grace. I'm going to keep it in my, every time I remember all that he's done for me, it gives me the capacity now to apply that to other people. I will remember God's grace for me. There's another verse on there. We're not going to read it. Go ahead and bow your heads.